Hello students, so last class I discussed about Bayes' theorem and concept learning. So in that I have discussed about the brute force Bayes' concept learning algorithm and the necessary derivations in detail. So in today's class I am going to discuss map hypothesis and the consistent learners, right? Here in the previous class, as I discussed about the analysis, so that analysis shows that in the given setting every hypothesis consistent with the capital D is a map hypothesis. So this statement will translate directly into an interesting statement about a general class of learners that we might call it as a consistent learners. So the concept of consistent learner is very important here. So I'll repeat. Here the map hypothesis, or whatever the statement I read out, that is every hypothesis which is consistent with capital D is known as a map hypothesis. In turn, it will translate directly into an interesting statement about a general class of learners, so that is known as the consistent learners. Here we can say that a learning algorithm is a consistent learner provided it outputs a hypothesis that commits zero errors over the training examples. So such learning algorithm can be considered as the consistent learner. I hope the statement is clear. So this is just a justification, right? So when you can say that the learning algorithm is a consistent learner, so the condition for that is the learning algorithm should output a hypothesis that commits zero errors over the training examples, then we can say that the learning algorithm is a consistent learner. So given this above analysis, we can conclude that every consistent learner output is a map hypothesis. So if you assume that a uniform prior probability distribution over H, that is P of H I equal to P of H J, something like that for all I and J instances, and if you assume the deterministic noise free training data. So when you can say that the deterministic noise free training data, that is a P of D bar H is equal to 1 if D and H are consistent, otherwise it is a 0, then you can say that it is a deterministic noise free training data. Now consider for example the concept learning algorithm, that is the Pandas, which I have discussed in one of the previous chapter. So here the Pandas, it searches the hypothesis space H from the specific to a general hypothesis, so that we know already, right? So always Pandas, it searches the hypothesis space H from the specific to general hypothesis, which will output a maximally specific a consistent hypothesis, because as we know the Pandas output a consistent hypothesis. So always it will output a map hypothesis under the probability distribution of P of H and P of D bar H, which was defined previously. Of course the Pandas, it does not explicitly manipulate the probabilities at all, but it simply output a maximally specific member of the version space. Here the Bayesian framework is a way to characterize the behavior of the learning algorithms. However, by identifying the distributions for P of H and P of D bar H under which its output hypothesis will be map hypothesis, so we have a useful way of characterizing the behavior of Pandas. As there are the other probability distributions for P of H and P of D bar H, so under which the Pandas output a map hypothesis. So this is what one question in front of us, that is, are there the other probability distributions for p of h and p of d bar h under which the findest outputs a map hypothesis. So this is what the question is. So the answer for this is yes. Yes, there are the probability distributions for, means there are the other probability distributions for p of h and p of d bar h under which the findest output the map hypothesis. Because findest output a maximally specific hypothesis from the version space, so its output hypothesis will be a map hypothesis which is relative to any prior probability distribution that favors the most specific hypothesis. So more precisely, suppose H is any probability distribution, that is P of H over the hypothesis space that assigns P of H1 which is greater than or equal to P of H2. If H1 is more specific than H2, then it can be shown that the findest output map hypothesis, which is assuming that the prior distribution for hypothesis space and the same distribution, that is the P of D by H. Now to summarize, the Bayesian framework, it allow one way to characterize the behavior of learning algorithms even when the learning algorithm does not explicitly manipulate the probability, means explicitly it will not change the probabilities or the probability distributions. So by identifying the probability distributions P of H and P of D bar H under which the algorithm, it may be the findest algorithm or any sort of learning algorithm, so that will output the optimal hypothesis. In turn, optimal hypothesis is nothing but the map hypothesis, right? Now we can characterize the implicit assumptions under which this algorithm behaves optimally, right? So now consider using the Bayesian perspective to characterize the learning algorithms. So it is very much similar to characterizing the inductive bias of the learner. So this above Bayesian interpretation, as it provides the alternative way to characterize the assumptions which is implicit in the learning algorithms. The next important concept is the maximum likelihood and the least squared error hypothesis. So this we have to study here with respect to the Bayesian learning, right? Of course, this concept was studied earlier also with respect to the other algorithms. So now let us understand these concepts, that is maximum likelihood and least squared error hypothesis with respect to the Bayesian learning, right? So as it is illustrated in the previous section, so the Bayesian analysis can sometimes be used to show that a particular learning algorithm outputs a map hypothesis even though it may not explicitly use the Bayes rule or calculate the probabilities in any form. So in this section, as we will consider the problem of learning a continuous valued target function. So a problem which is faced by many learning approaches such as the neural network learning, linear regression, the polynomial curve fitting and all, right? Here, straightforward Bayesian analysis will show that under certain assumptions, any learning algorithm that minimizes the squared error between the output hypothesis predictions and the training data, that will output a maximally likelihood or maximum likelihood hypothesis. So the significance of this result is that it provides a Bayesian justification for many neural network and the other curve fitting methods that attempt to minimize the sum of squared errors over the training data. Now consider the problem setting here. Here the learner L considers an instance space X and the hypothesis space H consisting of some class of real valued functions which are defined over capital X. That is, each H in H means each hypothesis in the hypothesis space is a function of the form this one, that is h colon x tends to r, where r represents the set of real numbers here. The problem which is faced by the learner, that is L, is to learn an unknown target function, that is f colon x tends to r. So the problem faced by the learner L is to learn an unknown target function, that is f colon x tends to r, where r represents again the set of real numbers. So which is drawn from H here. A set of m training examples is provided, where the target value of each example is corrupted by the random noise drawn according to the normal probability distribution. More precisely, each training example is a pair of the form xi di, where di is equal to f of xi plus ei. Here f of xi is the noise free value of the target function and ei is a random variable representing the noise. Now it is assumed that the value of ei, which is drawn independently and that are distributed according to the normal distribution with the zero mean. Here the task of learner is to output a maximum likelihood hypothesis, or equivalently a map hypothesis, assuming all the hypotheses that are equally probable a priori or not, right? So I hope it is clear what is the task of learner here. So the task of learner is to output a maximum likelihood hypothesis or equivalent a map hypothesis, assuming all the hypotheses are equally probable priori or not. That is what the task or the job of learner. Now consider a simple example of a such problem, that is learning a linear function. To our analysis applies to learning arbitrary real valued functions. Now as you can see in this figure, so this figure illustrates a linear target function f depicted by a solid line and a set of noisy training examples of this target function. As you can see, a solid line here, right? So this solid line will depict a linear target function f, right? The dashed line which correspond to the hypothesis, that is HML with the least squared training error, hence the maximum likelihood hypothesis. So here you can see two types of lines in this figure. One is solid line. Solid line will depict, means it will represent a linear target function, whereas a dotted line, it will represent the hypothesis HML with least squared training error, and hence it can be considered as the maximum likelihood hypothesis here. So one thing we can notice, that the maximum likelihood hypothesis is not necessarily identical to the correct hypothesis F, because it is always inferred from only a limited sample of noise training data. So before showing why a hypothesis that minimizes the sum of squared errors in this setting, that is also a maximum likelihood hypothesis. Now let us quickly review the two basic concepts from the probability theory. So one concept that I will discuss today and the other concept I will discuss in next class, right? Here the probability densities and the normal probability distribution. So first I will discuss probability density, right? Here, in order to discuss the probabilities over the continuous variables such as small e, we must introduce the probability densities, right? So here the reason why we wish for the total probability over all the possible values of the random variable to sum that thing to 1. So in the case of continuous variables, that we cannot achieve this by assigning a finite probability to each of the infinite set of possible values for the random variable. So instead we speak of a probability density for the continuous variables such as the small e, and require that the integral of this probability density over all the possible values is 1. So in general, we will use the lower case, that is capital P, to refer to the probability density function to distinguish it from a finite probability capital P. So the probability density P of x naught is a limit as it goes to zero of 1 by infinite times of the probability that x will take on a value in the interval, that is x naught comma x naught plus lambda. So this you can see here. So probability density function P of x naught equal to a limit of 1 by epsilon P of x naught less than or equal to x less than x naught plus epsilon, where epsilon tends to 0. So it's a clear probability density for the continuous variable. So it is represented as P of x naught equal to limit of 1 by epsilon into a P of x naught less than or equal to x less than x naught plus epsilon, where epsilon tends to 0. So this is what the first basic concept from the probability theory, that is the probability densities. And the next concept is the normal probability distribution. So this normal probability distribution that I will discuss in the next class. Thank you.